Good morning. Grace and peace to you on this beautiful morning. We've got a few announcements I want to draw to your attention. First of all, we have pecans for sale. They're here, so I did let the other churches know, so we should have a run on them at any moment. We have coming up tomorrow night our trustees and board meeting here at 7 o'clock. Because we're so few, if you know that you're not going to be able to make it, just let Peggy know so that if we need to reschedule so we have a quorum, we can do so. The reason being, we have some forms we're going to be going through in preparation for the SPRC meeting, so we have some things taken care of there. On Tuesday night, we will have the next Historic Paradise Church Cemetery Association meeting, 7 o'clock at St. James in Coburn. If you know anyone who is interested in the history and would like to be a part of the organization or just learn more about it, please invite them to that meeting. They can absolutely attend. And next Sunday, we're having a special message that is about why it is a historic landmark for the United Methodist Church. And certainly you can invite anyone to that. On Wednesday night, we have our third quarter Penns Valley Charge Staff Parish Relations Committee meeting, 7 o'clock here. And we will be discussing 2025 pastoral compensation that night. So if you have any questions or concerns, talk with Peggy or Julie. We have Thursday morning, Ladies Coffee and Conversation at 9:30 at St. James. And as I said, next Sunday is a special day. As far as the message goes about the history linked to the entire United Methodist Church, there's something that has not changed since the special general conference that happened in Coburn. We'll learn what that is next Sunday. And Sunday afternoon, we will have, next Sunday afternoon, our district conference gathering. Now, the district conference is gathering because we have changed our boundaries. We've redefined our district. We've taken some of a couple of other districts. So we are renaming it. We have a new name. I'm part of the steering committee. We did pick a name. It is the Mountain Valley District. It is the only description that really fully describes the entire district. It's mountains and valleys, because you're either one or the other. But that will be at 3 o'clock next Sunday afternoon. We will have worship, we will have some work, we will have some conferencing, and it's all there at Mount Nittany United Methodist Church in Lamont. If you're interested in helping out at St. James with their soup preparation next Wednesday, or the information's there about the Wednesday night shopping, and the parade soup sale information is there as well. We have our fall hayride and picnic coming up on the 29th. Make sure to let people know about that. And good news, found out today that the swing set is repaired. So we will have lots of juvenile joy going on at that picnic, so that there'll be a lot of swinging going on. But you can see there, we've got a lot of other things that are coming up. The Charge Conference, keep that in the back of your mind, a Tuesday night, October 29th at Faith in Spring Mills. And the information is there. And I see that there's something here about furniture available at St. James, so if you can pass that along, that would be very helpful. And, oh, if you're looking for furniture. I do know that they do have a lot of it. They've been storing it in one part of the church since, I think, last spring. Any other announcements to share this morning? Bless you. And seeing none, I would please ask that you direct your attention to our centering words for this morning. There is practice and there is purpose. Jesus clarifies that there is a difference. Devotion. Our hearts reveal our true devotion. Please rise in body or in spirit as we prepare our hearts for worship by singing together the sanctuary song.
True, with thanksgiving, I'll be.
join me now in the call to worship. We are called to follow Jesus. No. It will demand our dedication and our energy. Come, all of you, come and learn of the Lord Jesus.
Lord, we come, seeking your wisdom and your guidance.
Continuing now with the opening prayer. Lord, we have come this day to hear your words of healing love and hope. Enter our hearts and our spirits and teach us to follow you. Give us courage and strength to be your faithful disciples. Amen. Please open your hymnal to number 64. We're going to sing together, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Are offered in this moment and in every moment. In gratitude and grace, we bring our gifts this morning and offer them for God's blessing. Let us prepare for the blessing by singing together the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
Divine source of wisdom, we bring our offerings this morning with hearts attuned to your call. As we gather in your presence, may our gifts reflect the wisdom and discernment you desire for us. Use these offerings to nurture understanding, compassion, and justice in our world. Guide us to listen and act with insight, spreading your love and your grace. Transform our giving into actions that make a difference. Help us grow in our faith and grow in our commitment to your ways. In the name of Jesus, we pray, and all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. But we're going to go to God in silent prayer, share with God what's on our heart this morning, joys and concerns that we can't share out loud, and then we will all pray together. God of mercy and of hope, be with us this day. We've come here this morning to learn of your will for us. We already know what our will is. Sometimes it's not easy for us to realize that if we are to follow Jesus, we will have to make a total commitment to his ways. We will have to actually put into practice the good news of compassionate love and healing mercies on others that sometimes good people think are not good people. We read scripture all the time and we see how many times Jesus was judged for eating with people they did not care for. Our hearts today are filled with situations concerning family and friends, neighborhoods, the world. And we seek your healing mercies for these situations and all who are tangled in them. But help us to remember also that that same healing mercy is offered to each one of us. And honestly, God, help us to remember in those precious moments when we should that that healing mercy is offered to each one of us so that we can extend the same to others and give us the strength and courage to really follow Jesus' way. We are called to be people of prayer, so let us share the words that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In today's readings, we're going to hear a little bit of a collision between the letter of the law and the spirit behind it. If you get off too far on one side and not enough on the other, results can vary. We're going to go with that. We're going to begin with Proverbs chapter 1, verses 20 to 33. In this, woman wisdom, cries out to people to follow her way rather than the way of foolishness. And think about that, how that would have sounded to the original hearers. Wisdom shouts in the street. She lifts her voice in the square. At the head of the noisy streets, she cries out. At the entrance of the gates in the city, she utters her sayings. How long, O naive ones, will you love being simple-minded? And scoffers delight themselves in scoffing. And fools hate knowledge? Turn to my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit on you. I will make my words known to you. Because I called and you refused. I stretched out my hand and no one paid attention. And you neglected all my counsel and did not want my reproof. I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your dread comes. When your dread comes like a storm and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you, then they will call on me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but will not find me, because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. They would not accept my counsel. They spurned all my reproof. So they shall eat of the fruit of their own way and be satiated with their own devices. For the waywardness of the naive will kill them, and the complacency of fools will destroy them. But he who listens to me shall live securely and will be at ease from the dread of evil. The second reading is James chapter 3, verses 1 to 12. This letter of James speaks of all the strife and mischief that's caused by the misuse of speech. Our words really matter. They are a gift, and they're not to be misused. So hear these words. Let not many of you become teachers, my brethren, knowing that as such we will incur a stricter judgment, for we all stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to bridle the whole body as well. Now, if we put the bits into the horses' mouths so that they will obey us, we direct their entire body as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so great and are driven by strong winds, are still directed by a very small rudder wherever the inclination of the pilot desires. So also the tongue is a small part of the body, and yet it boasts of great things. See how great a forest is set aflame by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, the very world of iniquity. The tongue is set among our members as that which defiles the entire body and sets on fire the course of our life and is set on fire by hell. For every species of beasts and birds, of reptiles and creatures of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by the human race. But no one can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil and full of deadly poison. With it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come both blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be this way. Does a fountain send out from the same opening both fresh and bitter water? Can a fig tree, my brethren, produce olives, or a vine produce figs? Nor can salt water produce fresh. In our final passage, Jesus confronts the Pharisees, the guardians of the Jewish tradition, and their emphasis on ritual purity. While their intent to uphold religious practices is admirable, it's something they have been taught, they've also been taught how to go about it. And Jesus exposes a deeper issue about how they go about it. They've elevated human traditions over God's command, mistaking external rituals for true righteousness. That raises a vital question for us. How much of our faith is ritual, and how much reflects the heart of God's commands? So hear now the words of Mark 7, verses 1 through 8, 14 to 15, and 21 to 23, about followers of tradition. The Pharisees and some of the scribes gathered around Jesus when they had come from Jerusalem, and had seen that some of his disciples were eating their bread with impure hands, that is, unwashed. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they carefully wash their hands, thus observing the traditions of their elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they cleanse themselves. And there are many other things which they have received in order to observe, such as the washing of cups and pitchers and copper pots. The Pharisees and scribes asked Jesus, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat their bread with impure hands?" And he said to them, "Rightly did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far away from me. But in vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the precepts of men, neglecting the commandment of God. You hold to the tradition of men.'" After he called the crowd to him again, he began saying to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside the man which can defile him if it goes into him, but the things which proceed out of the man are what defile the man. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed the evil thoughts, fornications, thefts, murders, adulteries, deeds of coveting and wickedness, as well as deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, and foolishness. All these evil things proceed from within and defile the man." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I'm going to be breaking down some of these passages and going into a bit of specifics for this message called Dirty Hands and Clean Hearts. I know that one of my fondest memories was going fishing and eating the sandwiches that we brought along. How easy was it to wash your hands when you were at Sayers Dam, down where the road goes under the water, and you're getting ready to eat your sandwiches, back before they had all that wonderful gel stuff that you could put on your hands and get the bacteria off. We absolutely ate our sandwiches with dirty hands. But this is about religious traditions versus the heart of Scripture, what we heard in Mark 7. The Pharisees were concerned with ritual purity. Washing their hands before eating, this was not about hygiene, this was about ritual. This is how we do things. And it was part also of sacred traditions that were passed down by their elders. These practices were deeply embedded in their communal identity of Israel. It's something that set them apart, made them distinct from surrounding nations. And it was also a part of how they would honor their covenant with God. We do talk about being cleansed. We do talk about washing away sin. However, over time, these customs became ends in themselves. Sort of like someone would be able to use the excuse, "Well, it doesn't matter what I did, my hands were clean," right? Does it? Detached from their original spiritual meaning, a custom becomes somewhat lost because the why is lost. It's just a what. Jesus challenges the Pharisees with the quote from Isaiah 29:13, and I'm going to read part of it from the Message paraphrase, particularly that part. "These people make a big show of saying the right thing, but their hearts aren't in it." Now, we understand that as people who just say the right thing to get by. We've heard that used as also in terms of go along to get along. If you say the right thing, you get the right results. The problem was not necessarily with the traditions themselves, but with the way they had overshadowed the deeper call to love and obedience to God. The Pharisees had become so focused on outward conformity to be seen as obedient, which is a whole lot easier than trying to see inside someone's heart, that they lost sight of that inward transformation that we're called to have, really that's required even for them personally to really obey God's commands. And so Jesus says, it's not what goes in, but what comes out. In his response to the Pharisees, Jesus flips their understanding of purity. They believe as long as I take in the right things, I'm good. He says, it's not what you swallow that pollutes your life, it's what you vomit. That's the real problem. That's from the Message paraphrase. But the issue is not what enters the body, it's what flows from the heart. It's a heart issue. Anger, pride, jealousy, and other sins begin in the heart and then manifest outwardly and then affect relationships and then affect communities and then affect even our witness to God. What we allow into our heart impacts our heart for sure, but we control what we allow in and we control what we retain. We determine what's going to take up residence in our heart. You know, Jesus really went to some people with some issues and some problems that the good people would not even speak to. He took it all in. No one can see inside our hearts simply by judging external things. We know that. This teaching was a major shift, however, from what the Pharisees were taught to be focused on, because I'm going to cut them a little slack here. Tradition's called tradition for a reason. It's how we've always done it. Of course, it started somewhere. But their focus on ritual practices reminds us that God's concern is with our inner lives. It's with our thoughts, our intentions, our real desires. Quoting now a writer named Kyle E. Brooks, I think this is a wonderful quote. Traditions can be picked up and put down. And aren't they? Don't we have family traditions that we grew up with? And maybe when we go off and we set up housekeeping, we retain some of them. Maybe we don't retain all of them. Maybe we make new ones that our children enjoy. And then they set up housekeeping and maybe they take some of those traditions. Yes, traditions absolutely can be picked up and put down. But I'll continue. Our hearts, however, stay with us. And what they produce will ultimately reflect the content of our lives and intentions. Tradition has its place. And Jesus says that. Tradition has its place, absolutely, but it should never deter followers of Christ from the primary function of faith. Because then it is mere performance and nothing more. Now, that was part of the issue we heard from the prophet Isaiah. It was a problem of religious performance. Isaiah called out those who honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And if anybody who's ever had a defiant teenager look you square in the eye and say, I did what you told me to do, and then you have to sit them down and explain, it's not what you did, it's how you did it that reveals to me whether you're being truly obedient. It's how you feel about the people that you were doing it for, really feel about them, that teaches me if you're truly obedient. Religious performance was a problem. Doing what looks good and sounds good, maybe even to the self, which is really terrible because when we really think we're fooling ourselves, we're in trouble. But not to mention looks good or sounds good in front of others, it can give someone and people standing by a false sense of righteousness. Some love to be offended. I have seen eyes light up when they get offended because they know, oh, bring me my high horse. I've got work to do. It's the fastest way to feel superior and appear morally superior. Is that really what offense was for? Or was it for us to kind of take that emotion and say, why is this bothering me so much and what can I do to correct it? What is God's will for fixing this problem? Not just calling someone a name or judging someone guilty and then going on my merry way. We sometimes feel we're checking all the boxes when we do the things we've watched other people do, right? just like the Pharisees. We attend the services, we read the scripture, we follow the church traditions, whether they're denominational or the ones in our own churches. We use the specific tray, we use the specific cup that so-and-so said we always use when we do this. They become kind of a church family tradition. But if our hearts aren't aligned with God's will, these actions, no matter how deeply embedded or personally satisfying, they're hollow at best when we're more focused on the cup we're using, the tray we're using. Is that the old baptismal font or the new baptismal font? How can we know a practice from a purpose? Wisdom. In Proverbs 1, we heard about wisdom calling out in the streets, urging people to listen to her voice. It can be really hard when you're one voice out in the street and it's a very noisy street with a lot of people shouting. Amen? And we've got people shouting at us all day, every day. They're shouting from the TV set, from the radio, from our devices. They shout at us from newspapers and books. Are we seeking out that wisdom? Because true wisdom, like true worship, can't be reduced to a set of rules or rituals. It requires us to respond to God's call with open hearts and open minds and a willingness to learn. And even, God help me, a willingness to be corrected when I learn I am wrong. Seeking understanding for the personal of my own, or for the reason of my own personal transformation, becoming what God wills me to be, what God needs me to be, because God wants to transform the world through us, but that requires first that we be transformed by Him. We've been sharing over the last several weeks many of the ways by which we're transformed, that living water, our daily bread, our family of faith, our prayerful discernment, considering the wisdom of Scripture compared to the wisdom imparted to us by people. In the class that I'm taking right now, we had to write a paper, and in my paper I had mentioned about we were talking about how interesting it is that all of these things are in the Bible, and yet we still have people in the church who will say something's in the Bible that's not there, or completely dismiss things that they know are in the Bible as meaning what they mean. And I had a conversation with someone in the church a long time ago about women bringing people to Christ. And he said, it's in the Bible. Women don't do that. And I said, what Bible are you reading? He said, the same Bible you're reading. I said, I don't think you're reading it. I said, have you heard of the Samaritan woman at the well? He said, yes. I said, well, did you remember that Jesus knew the woman? He knew everything about her. Yes. Do you remember him telling her that he was the Messiah? It was the first person outside of the disciples to hear this. The first person was a woman. It was a Samaritan woman. There was no good such thing as a good Samaritan in that day. That's why the good Samaritan is such an important parable. Yes, he knew that. I said, when she went to tell everybody that she knew, did Jesus say, stop, wait, go get that man that you're living with, have him do it? No. Did he say, stop, you can't do that, you can't go bring people to me? No. Tell me again how Jesus doesn't want women to do that. Well, it's in the Bible, and people have been telling me about it my whole life. People have been telling you. I said, you never sat down and let God talk to you. We can be creatures of habit who tend to prefer to think we know. And I've lived too long to fall into that trap all the time, because there's too much I don't know that I don't know. And we all get in trouble when we assume. And human beings prefer the good-looking fruit, right? Did you ever pick a really good-looking apple, get it home, and find out it's rotten inside? I have. I did that recently when making apple dumplings. I was very disappointed. God needs you to be able to see what's below the surface. And not just see it, try to be as interested as God is in finding out. Because God is so much more concerned about what's going on with that person than what that person's wearing, what that person studies, how many tattoos they have, how many piercings they have. He is so concerned about how they're living. He's concerned about their future. He's concerned about their family. He's concerned about their health. He's concerned about their mental health. He's concerned about whether they're eating, have a place to live, have clothes to wear, shoes on their feet. That's what Jesus struggled to help the disciples to understand. We need to be tending to them. And the hardest part to get through was the tongue. In James 3, we heard about the power of the tongue because James emphasizes that the heart is reflected in our speech. I'm going to read it again, another part of the passage from the Message paraphrase. A word out of your mouth may seem of no account, but it can accomplish nearly anything or destroy it. I have watched people want to turn their lives around, make the decision they're going to turn their lives around. They've come out of prison. They've come out of addiction. They want so much for their family to encourage them and to back them up. And when they go to them and share what they're going to do, words happen. They don't get the encouragement that they were hoping for. In one case, it was, I'll believe it when I see it, but I don't think it's going to happen. Fortunately for that person, they were able to sever ties with that person for the duration it took for them to really work through. And now they struggle to be with them. So now they're working through the fact that now they are the ones who need the forgiveness. See, things have flipped. The tide has turned. They now have to be the one who's going to be forgiving. So words are a very big deal because they reveal the state of our heart. And if our heart's filled with bitterness, jealousy, or pride, it'll be evident in the words we use and how we use them. But if our hearts are filled with love, humility, wisdom, the want and desire to see past what is on the surface, it's going to be felt and heard because we're going to be building up, not tearing down. What do we want our words to accomplish for God? Well, we have to ask God what he needs our words to accomplish for him. Traditions, doctrines, and human-made customs are not necessarily inherently wrong. When applied with a Christ-centered purpose, they help us maintain our connection to our history, our community, and our shared faith. But when they overshadow the true spiritual commitment and grow into being more about appearances than actual transformation, we risk missing the heart of what God desires. The point being, God is not as concerned with our rituals as we may be. The devil is in the details, right? God is concerned about the condition of our hearts and the way we go about those wonderful things that Jesus calls us to do as ritual. As we live out our faith, God looks not at the outward appearance, but at the heart. We may not always look the part, but if our hearts are right with God, if they reflect love, humility, and devotion, caring for the marginalized and oppressed, then we're walking that true path of righteousness. The beautiful thing about that is there have been times when I have apologized to someone with absolute 100% sincerity, and they did not accept it. That's hard, isn't it? It's deeply hard. But the thing about that is, God knows. I can try again until I can't try again. But I can get a lot of comfort in knowing God knows my heart. God knows if it was sincere or not. I heard something yesterday that I thought was a pretty good way to end the message, since it's a hard one. And it was on a church sign. God wants spiritual fruit, not religious nuts. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, search our hearts today and strip away any pretense or performance that might have been put there and nurtured that keeps us at arm's length from you. Help us not to, or help us rather to live not by our outward appearances, but by inward devotion, aligning our hearts with your will over our own. May our words, actions, and traditions reflect a deep love for you and deep caring for others that would otherwise be forgotten. Like the disciples, we do struggle to understand the difference between status and authority and responsibility. But may we bear fruit that brings honor to your name. And for that, we will give you the glory. It's in Jesus' name that we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Would you please rise in body or in spirit as you feel led to sing together our closing hymn, Sent Forth by God's Blessing, 664. Jesus, give your lives to his service by serving and caring for others. Be in peace and go in peace and know that God walks with you on this journey and knows your heart. Bring the good news of Christ's healing love to all you meet. Amen.